Let's have a look at systems software, which includes operating systems, the language interpreter, booting the system, and utility programs. So you probably have a phone and you understand what apps are. So the phone is hardware and apps is short for application software. So there's a layer in between the hardware and the apps. That's called system software. So when you get your device, you've already got software on there. That's the system software. The apps that you add on is application software. So what is system software? Well, the major part is the operating system, and that manages the device. So it could be your phone, it could be your computer, your laptop. There are also utility programs that help maintain your device. And there's also other programs that are not the operating system and they're not really apps. So when you boot a device, you do load the operating system, but there's some stages before that. So we'll look at that. Language interpreter we'll look at next, and also drivers. So the language interpreter. So you're used to using your device, you may have touch screen, you can use sounds, speech, keypad, or keyboard and mouse, or even a pen. So we interact with our device and tell it what we want to do. Now the device doesn't really understand that, it understands zeros and ones, which we call the machine language. So we give it instructions and we kind of understand we write that in code. So how does it turn what we do into the zeros and ones? Well, for example, when we click on an app, that runs. And what that does, it runs a file. And that file is called an executable file. So what's inside that file is code, is instructions. And that needs to be turned into the machine language. And that is done by the language interpreter. So for example, if it's in something called like Java or C or C++ programming language, it will be compiled into machine language. Other languages such as Python uses an interpreter, and assembly language uses an assembler. But the language interpreter changes the code, the instructions, into the machine language so the device, the phone or the computer, can run the program, run the instructions. Now, when you turn your computer on, that's called booting. So, booting is the process of starting or restarting a computer. So, what happens? Let's say you switch your device on. Now, that makes a signal go to something on the CPU, the brain of the computer. So, there's something called a reset pin. Now, the CPU then sends a message to something called a read-only memory chip that's probably on your motherboard in your computer, and that contains what's called the BIOS, which is the basic input and output system. Now that performs a test called a power on self test, and what the BIOS does, it checks that all the components are working correctly. So when you switch your computer on, is everything going to run okay? So the system files, the operating system, are loaded into memory so your computer can now run how you wish it to do. And that includes the operating system, and that loads all the configurations, the things that it needs to run, displays the desktop, what you'll see, and then your login details. So your operating system will show you all the things that you need to see and also run the parts of the computer that also needs to run before you start running your programs like your apps. So that's what happens when you boot a computer. So we've mentioned operating systems. Now you're probably familiar with this type of screen. On the laptop we have the CPU inside, same as other computers, that's connected to a motherboard, that's connected to all the devices. So it needs some type of software to manage all those operations. That's called the operating system. So if we look at computer operating systems, you're probably familiar with Windows, that's used mainly in the office, and you may use it at home. You may prefer Mac computers, so that has a Mac operating system that runs on it. Linux is a popular operating system that's free, and it's similar to an old type of operating system called Unix that was developed in the 70s, and that allowed multiple users to use computers. So there are all types of operating systems. If we look at the market share during 2019, you can see the different forms of Windows, the different versions, very popular. And also we have things like the Mac operating system and Linux. Now a phone is a different device. It needs a smaller CPU and it can't get so hot, so it can't perform as many operations so quickly. So it does need processors for different parts. With the phone now, we have quite an advanced screen and camera, different parts of the phone. So it needs a different type of operating system. It does need an operating system, but a different type than a computer. Now, you're probably familiar with the main two, the iPhone with the iOS, the operating system, and Android. But there are others. If we look at the market share, you can see Android and iOS have most of the market share, but you can see operating system like KaiOS that has now reached third place. That might seem quite small, but that's still over 100 million users. So that's the Android and iOS mainly for smartphones, but this is the market share for all phones. So what do operating systems do? Well, operating system is a collection of programs that together run the management of all computers' files, storage, hardware devices, and software. So that includes starting and shutting down a computer, providing the user interface, the thing that you can see. Managing programs. We often want to use more than one program at the same time, so we can run different programs. The operating system helps us with that. That needs memory. So operating system manages the memory and all the input and output devices. We can coordinate tasks, manage networking, such as your internet connection, monitor performance of the computer to make sure it's working correctly. So that involves dealing with updates and security. So we manage memory. We use the RAM, random access memory, like the chips that you can see here. And we can also use virtual memory that acts as additional RAM, such as on your hard drive. We have folders on a computer. Other operating systems call these folders directories. So we can have folders and subfolders, or directories and subdirectories, and these store files. The files are either programs that we run, or they can hold data. When you want to access these files, the computer knows where they are by using the path. So here's an example of you have a folder name, a subfolder name, and a file name. The computer can do several tasks at the same time. So this is called multitasking. We can think of multitasking as one user doing many tasks with one processor, whereas multiprogramming, we might have multiple users at the same time using one processor. Time sharing is when we have the multiple users taking turns with that processor, and multiprocessing, having one or more users at the same time on two or more processors. The operating system deals with security, so things like username and passwords, automatic updates, and also what you see, which we call a graphical user interface. This type of interface allows us to just click on pictures, called icons, and drag them, for example, rather than having to use just text and typing that out, like people had to do years ago. Additional to your operating systems are utility programs, and you can see them, for example, in system tools. So what do we have in utility programs? Well, backup and data recovery, so you can save your files and recover them at a later day. We have virus protection, so protect ourselves, our devices against malware, viruses, and remove them. Disk cleanup removes unnecessary files. Data compression helps compress or uncompress contents to increase the ability to store data or files. Defragmentation reorganizes the files and the unused space on the hard drive. So the hard drive collects a lot of files, puts them in different places, it's not very organized. So defragmentation reorganizes them. That kind of makes the computer a bit, it makes it easier to find the files for the computer. Drivers are small programs that tell the operating system how to communicate with a specific device. So, for example, if you purchase a printer and you connect it to your computer, it generally will connect okay, but you need a driver to tell the operating system what type of printer it is and how to work it. So each model of printer requires its own drivers. So you can't get a driver with the operating system. It has to be specific to the device. So that's an example of a driver. Okay, thank you for watching. If you haven't already, please subscribe.